Yeah, squirrel, no doubt. Hey, how are you?
I didn't expect the camera.
No, I didn't expect the camera either. All right, so how many of you, if any of you, were in our presentation last year on a similar topic? Oh, good. All right. So last year we kind of got pigeonholed into the last day of the, or the last time frame of the last session. On the last day, we had about half the time. And so we didn't actually get to cover a lot of what we wanted to do. So this year they kind of asked us, take what we had, make it new, and then ultimately cover the things that you were supposed to cover last time. So we've done that. We've updated it to focus on, as the title talks about, cloud computing and achieving Zen through what we like to call Winnovation. So, oh, and by the way, I'm Hoff, and that's Mogull. Just in case you didn't, I'm taller. So it really is hard to believe that it's been a year since we have. I'm going to drive the camera guy crazy, aren't I? It's been a year since we've done this. Ultimately, there has been a lot going on, right? All the bad politics, that whole Michael Jackson thing, which was kind of
tragic.
Yeah.
Still Kevin recovering.
So I got a new job at the Jolly Green Giant, and Rich got a new kid. Right? Isn't she cute? Yeah, gratuitous awe. Thank you.
Can you put the picture back up? There wasn't enough.
Oh, not enough awe.
I need the reinforcement.
Sorry.
That I
So it's her birthday today, and yes, it's very true. She likes cash. Speaking of which, the economy is still in the toilet, if you haven't figured that out, right? We need to cut budgets again, reduce headcount, say goodbye to professional development, and sadly, drinking in the bar of the W does not qualify for CPEs. Trust me, we both tried. Management kind of expects you to do that all the time, right? And they expect you to kind of do the bare minimum, which in many cases relates to the C word that we love so much.
Compliancy,
which is not really a word, I'm told, but we use it anyway. So what's very interesting about this is, as we've seen this compression, we're supposed to deal with all this stuff and move all our stuff to the cloud tomorrow, right? That's really where this is headed. And what we're faced with, and what we talk to with Rich and his business, And the stuff that I talk to our customers in every day, is ultimately the fact that they're very, very panicked, concerned about what that really means. In the meantime, executives sitting there, and they basically just tell you that you should just suck it up, right? Ultimately, do more with less. That's what you're supposed to do, right? Do more with less, right? Wrong. Okay, so doing more with less is still, as it was last year, a really crappy solution to an even crappier set of problems. So if we could do less with more, we already would, and we wouldn't be in this position. So we need to do more with what we already have. And that sounds almost like a cop-out and a little bit too convenient a statement to make, but we need to do it better. And in many cases, to do that, we're told that, well, what you really ought to do is think like the business. Or depending upon what you do in your day job, you're told you're supposed to think like the enemy. Like the people that are attacking you. We suggest really that what you need to do is think like an entrepreneur, which really means making bold and correct bets. And in the midst of all the chaos, when you really have time, when you barely even have time for a cup of coffee, and you got to roll out an enterprise-wide deployment of web application firewalls across an entire enterprise, you know, what you really, really absolutely need to do is learn to game this system. And this isn't one of those kind of self-righteous, pompous things where we're going to tell you, here's the five things that you just don't know that you're supposed to do, that you can do, and make all your pain go away. At the same point in time, it's also not magic. And when we think about the sets of problems we have, we start thinking about a lot of what we're going to talk about as it relates to cloud. We can either see this as a problem set, or we can see it as a set of solutions. And really, anybody can do it. And the way we do it here, you might ask yourself how, and we're going to show you. So innovation really loves a crisis, right? So when we think about innovation as is classically defined is clearly the fact that your slides leave off a T. So hat is disruptive innovation. Anyway, disruptive innovation is really, in the context of this discussion, was framed by Clayton Christensen, where he basically said it's in the concept of technology, it's something that overturns the status quo, right? It could be a product, it could be a service, it could be an approach. Innovation in and of itself for technologies oftentimes aren't intrinsically disruptive themselves. It's the effects of the technology that actually become disruptive. So, for example, a particular technology enables a new way of thinking, a new way of doing something. But the technology itself, maybe it's not that disruptive. Maybe it's an improvement upon what we already have. It could also be When you think about disruption, it can be disruptive not only to the end user, but somewhere down the supply chain. Right? It doesn't have to be the end result or the end consumer. And ultimately, it could be incremental, or it could be very large, revolutionary or evolutionary. I'm tired. You know, we hear those buzzwords all the time. So, some examples of innovation.
Yeah, I mean, these are some of the things we see. Mainframe computers clearly were innovative, and then we had those transitions, disrupted innovation into the client-server environment. And, you know, keep in mind, it's not like all of our mainframes went away, but clearly it completely changed sort of how we approached our computing infrastructures, how we designed our applications. And now, of course, you're taking those mainframes and put them on the internet. Long-distance telephone calls. Who here does not use VoIP for their long-distance calls these days? Okay, really? Where do you live? Korea? North Korea. Okay, got it. Gasoline automobiles moving over across to hybrids. Bookstores, Amazon.com has totally screwed up that market. All my favorite small bookstores are out of business. So these are just some examples of these disruptive things. What happens with disruptive innovation is that when something has happened, once that event has occurred, things are never going to be the same afterwards. So you're going to be forced into either responding to that in some way, or you're going to pay the price for that. So, you know, could you have seen this stuff coming? Yeah, absolutely you could have seen all of these things coming, because it's not rocket science. You have to treat disruptive innovation not as something that happens to you, like, you know, the music industry. Oh my God, if we could just get rid of computers, then people will buy our CDs again, or records, or whatever else, tapes, 8-tracks?
What is that?
I don't know, something like that. But as something that you can actually go ahead and embrace, and something that you can go ahead and manage. So we're all stuck in the present, we're dealing with the boat anchors of the past, we can't move forward, we all love to hate the security industry, but you can't blame the system when you are helped create it, when we all helped create it. So as consumers of the solutions, you should know how they come about, and you should understand actually the forces of innovation. So if we look at innovation, let's take innovation from the business side. If you're a regular business out there, which most of you are, it's really three things that you're going to deal with, three ways that you're kind of innovations that you have to worry about. You're going to innovate either to gain competitive advantage. You come up with some new technology or something else to beat the competition. You're going to have to innovate as a competitive response because somebody innovated before you. Or maybe you're going to do a little bit about efficiency. And let's be honest, we don't worry too much about that. Most of us, although if you're a company like, you know, Walmart, for example, efficiency is absolutely everything they care about because of all the numbers and how those things add up. Now, in security, it's way different. Security, we are always in a far more reactive position. With security, we have to deal with three kinds of issues. One is we have the business who is innovating. They're doing it for all those other reasons we talked about. They want to gain competitive advantage. They want to do a competitive response, whatever it is. Or they find some new widget that they think is going to make them more efficient, but really just makes the CEO look cool when he's doing an interview on CNN. So we have to respond to all of their innovations. We have to respond to the bad guys. The bad guys are innovating for every reason we saw on the previous slide. It just happens to be that we are their product, or our stuff is their product that they sell to other people. And so we're having to respond to the innovation that the bad guys are coming up with, and then maybe we have some of our own internal efficiency stuff that we're doing on. So I think this is one of the reasons that in security we get all sort of wrapped up in our heads about, you know, we got to skate ahead of the puck, and we got to do this, and we have to predict the future. Well, you only can to a certain point. Security is always going to be a responsive game, but the real issue is going to be how quickly do you respond and when do you notice those key indicators so that you're able to turn those things around to your advantage before it's too late.
So there's a couple of interesting ways of looking at that. When we, in many cases, when we look at what disruptive innovation means, especially in the technology space and related to security, people get caught up in kind of timelines, or they lose perspective of timelines. And in terms of the evolution of a lot of what is developed in our industry, there's the kind of slow and incremental progress that we, and given the short, relatively short time frame and window associated with IT, see. But what's very interesting about that is if you actually go back and play back what has developed over time in terms of the response of the security industry, what it really maps to very interestingly is something called the theory of punctuated equilibrium. And the theory of punctuated equilibrium means that instead of having very slow, kind of very, you know, long-paced, spread out, small little blips along the timeline, what actually happens is you get these big, gigantic oscillations that over time, kind of big swings and then settle down until things, in terms of diversity, almost approach homogeneity, and then you get another big spike again. So rather than just little incremental blips, it really looks a lot different. But over time, if you were to stretch that timeline out, kind of smooths the curve. So it really looks more like classical dampened oscillations, a lot more like this instead of just straight lines. So what's interesting about that is even though at the end it's compressed, if we see another cycle like this, it really means it's cyclical. And because it's cyclical, it means it's predictive. The difficulty when we think about technology in these big swings is figuring out where and when it's going to happen, not if. So what's really interesting about that is if we take a look at what that means to us in terms of how we invest in security as a response to stimuli, like what Rich said, ultimately, we reference the all-too-important and soon-to-be-famous hamster security sine wave of pain. With all due respect to Andy Jackleth and his hamster sine wave of pain, I think, or hamster wheel of pain. So on the x-axis is time, over time. On the y-axis is how we invest and where we invest in security. So ultimately, at the bottom of this graph, you have host-centric investments. Then you go up to application-centric, information-centric, user-centric, and network-centric. And over time, you could pick an arbitrary spot. But let's say we start with host. And what we've seen is we're going to make survivable systems. We're going to deal with basically attacks against our host by deploying agents. Over time, depending on the threat, we deploy 27 agents on that box. After a while, we're at 94% CPU utilization based on the agents. You can't get to work. You replace that with a super agent. That doesn't work so well. So you say, you know what? Instead of a host, we're going to fix the application. So then we invest in SDLC, which gets us partway down the road, and we start fixing applications, and we make a ton of money. We break all the applications. We realize we can't be agile because ultimately our ability to respond in time to the business is complicated by the fact that we're injecting all these security requirements that didn't exist for the last 30 years. So we say, you know what? What we ought to focus on is instead the information. So we say, fantastic. We'll secure the information. Where the hell is it? And it's everywhere. So we start deploying technology and trying to do asset classification, and we realize we have zero control. We're having a very difficult time finding out where it is, let alone how we're going to protect it. So what this means is it's a user problem. We're going to stop the users from doing stupid human tricks, stop the monkeys from pushing the wrong button. So we invest in awareness training, meanwhile investing in all these other things, and the monkeys still push the wrong buttons, and they trade their passwords for chocolate bars, and they do all that stuff. So we say, you know what? Users are an interesting problem. So what we ought to do is the network. The network will fix this, right? I have 10 gig pipes into my consolidated fabrics. I'm going to be able to do, that's right. We encrypt all our traffic now, so I can't see all the content. So you know what? Let's go back to those user problems. This goes on and on and on. How many agents, network devices, awareness training, user-centric, application-centric things have you deployed in your career, even if it's 4 or 5 years? A lot. So what's interesting about this sine wave of pain is if you interpose it, for example, with an inverted, with a cosine, which is 180 degrees out of phase, what you'll notice if we label that wave, that disruptive wave, let's just call it disruptive innovation. And let's say we take and pick a spot where this red line is, and we'll say it's the emergence of virtualization and or cloud computing. What you'll notice is where we are in the industry as a response to threats is investing, for example, let's say at the network layer. So in many cases when we had servers and they were all physically connected to switches, we thought we'd put a bunch of stuff in switches and we'd be happy and fine. Speeds and feeds ultimately didn't work out that way. We encrypted everything. At the same time, we had disruptive innovation occur with virtualization, which forced all our controls where? Out of the network and into the guest or host again. So as an industry, we're up there. As a need and as a user community, we're down here. We're 180 degrees out of phase, right? Which is generally what happens. Oftentimes, you cross the x-axis. Sometimes you get lucky. Sometimes the two developments converge. And quite honestly, that's where we are now. We're at the intersection of trending between where industry is and starting to catch up with some of this stuff, and ultimately where cloud and virtualization are starting to take us. So we're in a very interesting spot in our ability to deal with that. We originally had a tablet application that was going to let us do all sorts of interesting things, but like draw over the other curve that's missing, because I'm not a very good artist, but my ferrets ate it. So I'm just going to ask you to imagine yet another curve, which is actually a threat curve. So what we have are innovative folks that are just as interested at timing where the industry is versus where we are and injecting their own amounts of disruptive innovation. So those curves are really messy. They don't look like nice, smooth sine waves. But this point illustrates the fact that ultimately, when we're here and our needs and deployment materials are down there, that's problematic. If you want a better poignant example of this, these concentric rings are basically how you enjoy compute. How centralized or decentralized data is, and then ultimately the speeds and feeds and ubiquity of connectivity. So if you start with mainframes, We went from mainframes with dumb terminals with low speed but reliable connectivity. You went around the clock, you passed minis, you went to client server, where we got kind of more, a little bit more central, a little bit more decentralized. Computers on the other end were able to do more. We went to kind of Web 1.0, where it got more decentralized but richer computing experiences all at the same time on the backside. We're kind of at Web 2.0, the emergence of kind of re-centralization and mashups and distributed capabilities. And right about now, we're at this weird divergence when we have those, the iPhones, right? We have mobile platforms. So we have mass re-centralization of compute on the backside with cloud computing, where there's apps and data all live. And then we have mass decentralization of applications and information on these things that 10, 20 years ago were supercomputers. So what's very interesting is our response as an industry, from a security perspective, has been remarkably predictable, right? At each turn of events, it's been that thing. Or more specifically, as Gunnar Peterson says, developmentally, if you map our response over time to programming languages, we have been remarkably consistent, at least, in our response to dealing with this. Network firewalls and SSL have been on a variation of a theme, when you think about it, a response to every major computing paradigm shift and developmental platform propagation that we've had thus far. And that's really not going to work so well going forward. So at each period swing, we really do change. Once in a while they're big, once in a while they're not. So what we really want to understand is how we predict these things, right? So to look forward and understand what's coming, in many cases, we need to look backwards.
If we look at, Chris and I first gave this presentation 3 years ago. It's got it on the frickin' slide, so.
I think it was three, yes. Yeah. I think
10 minus three. 7 is 3.
You just had a new baby, yes.
I am edumacated. Yeah, you know, so back in 2007, these were the
you were a Gartner analyst, so I guess, you know,
being able to add
was not really a requirement, clearly.
Yeah, it's 0.9 is
point,
the answer.
Right, 0.9. Yeah. And it's magic somewhere in a quadrant.
If we look at the predicted, the disruptive innovations that we predicted, and this is no BS, this is a slide we came up with back then, where we're looking at the outsourcing of IT, the consumerization of IT, software as a service, virtualization, reperimeterization, information centricity in the next generation of data centers. And conveniently enough, all of those things, if we kind of redefine them in a modern language, is basically, I'm not saying that is the cloud, but cloud computing encompasses those major trends that we talked about before. So what does this all mean? First of all, it means that your 3-year security plan it means nothing.
Well, unless you're us, because clearly we predicted all this.
Yeah, we got it right. But don't always get it right.
No.
A quote I usually use in my last presentation, I was fortunate a few years ago, I got to hang out and have beers with Bruce Sterling, the science fiction author. And he said this amazing thing where, you know, in his mind, 1 to 3 years is kind of like what analyst types or people who do this stuff can do. 3 to 5 years gets pretty fuzzy, and then 7 years, well, anything 7 years out is science fiction. That's as far as he's concerned where he kind of kicks into these things. So what does this all mean? Well, your plan needs to be dynamic. You need to manage to disruptive innovation, not fight it, not try and manage against it. So how do we do that? Well, you need to understand the innovation adoption process. You need to grok the innovation pipeline itself. We've all seen this. Jeffrey Moore?
Yeah, Jeffrey Moore.
Jeffrey Moore, Crossing the Chasm. All of this stuff is predictable in terms of the swing of technology being adopted. You know, when I saw analysts going out there and saying, you will never see iPads in the enterprise. Like, how freaking stupid are you? I mean, come on. Have you not watched any innovative product as it's hit? Maybe it takes 3 years, 5 years, 1 year. Who knows? It's going to happen across that. So you need to look at your portfolio, classify, make short, mid, and long-term investments. Understand that not all of your technology investments need to live for 10 years, and that's actually kind of a joke because I know a lot of you are on 30-year technologies back there. Classify these things as strategic and tactical. Understand some of these things are going to die before they depreciate. Now, this might seem like common sense, but I don't know. I mean, it seems to be in kind of rare supply these days. So you want to go ahead and evaluate portfolio and just understand that your responses and how you manage for innovation, how you manage your technologies, this is not always about buying new shiny stuff either. It's about doing the right things for the right reasons with the right outcome and then providing the transparency of how good or bad you are managing that. And there is what is now the most important slide in this entire presentation.
No pressure.
It was last year's most important slide in this entire presentation. I think the sine wave one's been.
This one's all right.
Anyway,
so I use this next coming slide to my advantage. I was the CISO of a $25 billion financial service institution. And it occurred to me that our investments along these pathways were very, very reactive, and we didn't actually know whether or not the investments we were making were effective in response to being reactive or even being predictive. We just had no real way of measuring it. And we didn't want to get caught up in the ROI discussion. Who here loves ROI security discussions? Aren't they fabulous? So we were really interested in, and I came up with this term, well, I think I came up with this term. If not, I'll claim it anyway. RROI, the reduction of risk on investment, not the return on investment. I really want to understand whether or not what I was getting was actually valuable to my company, right? So what I did was I asked the folks to gather like a catalog of all of our compensating controls, all the things we did, and I went to the whiteboard and I drew this thing up. So the x-axis is kind of security impact, what it meant to my team, my ability to protect and secure assets. The x-axis was the business impact. Ultimately, what did this mean to the business's ability to conduct and continue to conduct itself? And the dots were, as are color-coded indexes, our investments. And these were just some of them. Firewall, IPS, identity access management, database monitoring, authentication, et cetera, et cetera. Can anybody guess what the size of the dots means? Cost, right. How much money we invested. So if you look at this graph and you say, huh, all right. So if I have this gigantic bubble that is low business investment and low security, low business impact and low security impact, and it's a big investment, is that something I should continue investing in? And what it did was, we'll get to you in a second, what it did was kind of raise our awareness, even at a grand level or a gross level, as to what it was we were spending our money on. In some cases, and this was arbitrary, so all the IDS fan people, please don't kill me. I just used it as an example. Actually, Richard Steen invented
that
one.
It's dead.
Yeah, it's dead anyway, so don't worry about it. So we were able to map that. And what we basically started doing is making decisions that kind of started bordering on how we manage risk, right? It didn't look like it, but it was the first inklings to what we were doing. But it was a way for us to kind of look at how we were doing what we were doing and perhaps why and start to map it. Did you have a question?
There's a microphone there.
Yeah,
we're
right
recording
there.
This.
You mean that in the word impact in the good way or the what a train does when it wrecks?
Yeah, so it depended on who I was showing it to.
Okay.
Honestly, right? If I needed budget, it was horrible. But that's a great question. So this is meant to just be an abstract of a lot of background material that went into it, but that's a good question. Sometimes we would literally show it as disruption to the business, because we could deploy inline devices and we put things like web application firewalls in the first generation that broke every single app, but were very high value to us because it defended everything, but it also broke everything. So we had to be very careful about how we quantified that. We had a lot more risk management metrics behind it. But again, this is just kind of a cutesy graph. So it was the most important slide last year. It clearly needs to be updated.
Well, remember, with rare exception on security, I hate to say we love talking about being a business enabler. We love talking about growing the business. Very few industries are we going to grow the business. So if we're having business impact, it's either we're keeping the business alive, which we're defining as security impact, or we're causing problems for the business.
Right. So what we found is that remarkably, at all of these points, we had a lot of the tools. We had almost all the tools that we needed to make good decisions. Maybe not to protect or defend, but to make good decisions about how we should proceed. So the point ultimately there was that you shouldn't be surprised by disruptive innovation. You should really look at it as an opportunity. And I know that's easy to say, like, yeah, dude, I need another thing to defend, like I need a hole in the head. But the reality is, in many cases, if you look out at what's coming, again, a lot of this stuff is predictable. The time frame of when it will appear may not be predictable, but being able to start thinking about what this means to you, especially since a lot of this stuff is variations of the theme. How many of you have heard that cloud computing is just mainframes with internet connectivity? Right. You may not agree with it, but the reality is, in certain cases, when you extrapolate back to core competencies, we're doing a lot of the things that virtualization enabled in terms of consolidation to get us there. So the point here is to make innovation work for you. So you have a choice, right? You can
harness innovation and enjoy it.
And that's a chipmunk, not a squirrel, unfortunately.
I know. It's the closest we could get. Or
what is that?
That's a rodeo clown being gored. It was actually hard. I do Google image searches or Bing image searches. It was hard to find a rodeo clown.
A rodeo clown getting gored.
Yeah.
Yes, I
took
can
a little
why.
Bit of time. That's why we were almost late submitting.
Yes. It. So you should really take your pick, and we'll help. How? With the power of Winnovation. Yes, friends. Winnovation.
Winnovation.
Yes. We screwed up the queue. Yeah. So anyway, so now we're actually going to continue on. That was like what we talked about last year, right? And what we really want to focus on are some examples of what that means. So think about what we just talked about. Think about disruptive innovation, managing the process, understanding the pipeline, knowing that you're all going, these schmucks don't have to do my day job. I've got all these IDS alerts. I got PCI compliance I got to deal with. You know, it's easy for you to say. But at the same point in time, everything we're about to talk about is happening to you anyway. And I think in many cases, we really just have to take the time to focus on not only the present, but the future. And you know, that's why they call the future a gift, because it's the present. You like that one? I got that from, that didn't work too well. All right, so continuing on from last year, where are you going? All right, so continuing on from last year, we ran out of time last year, not because we had a short compressed cycle, because my co-presenter took up like the entire session with his foul, foul potty mouth, using words that rhymed with that, which, our scores would have been perfect fives had you not done that, by the way.
I thought you were joking.
So the trick is really not about trying to perfectly predict the future, but using some key indicators and correcting course before it's too late, because really that's what this is, right? When you look at those big bursty pendulums, you don't know if a lot of the stuff that's coming at you is really, is it a feature? Is it a market? Is it something I have to deal with? How do I know what to embrace, what to put on my radar, how I evaluate that against the rest of the portfolio, right? You don't want to ultimately plunge off the cliff before it's too late. So as an example, we're going to focus on cloud, because this is something that if you saw virtualization happening, you know, starting about 5 years ago, when it really started to crop up and people really were using terms like agility and cost savings and flexibility in ways that truly were indicative of what virtualization was starting to bring. Most of us, I mean, cloud computing really entered the vernacular about 2 years ago. We started calling it utility and grid before that, which were kind of misnomers. But we didn't really know what that meant. We had inklings. And if you look back and you look at Nick Carr's book, right, where everything, if you read that now, it just seems like, how could I have missed this? You know, the electrical grid, everything instead of standalone power generators became a utility. You kind of feel stupid. You're like, yeah, of course this is going to happen. It's natural. But the funny thing is, we talk about cloud as though it's a destination. Like we're just going to stop there. Like we're going to, like next year, somebody's going to ship cloud in a box and we're going to put it somewhere and that's the end. Well, it's not.
That was Cisco.
Shut up. So anyway, we're going to focus on cloud computing, and specifically two elements of cloud computing, and one in with a lot of emphasis. That's why it's in red. More specifically, kind of application resiliency or survivability, making things more defendable out of the box, and really this notion of information centricity. Was it last year or the year before that the entire RSA show started using stuff we wrote about in like 2005? Yeah, remember last year all the messaging was like information-centric security. Right, that's where that message was. And we thought that was kind of funny because that's exactly what we were talking about that year. But information centricity, if you remember the hamster sine wave of pain, is talking about how we focus on protecting the things that matter most. But before we get there, let's start with a little prudent risk management discussion, because there's no good security talk that you can have without risk management discussions.
Yeah, and the reason we're talking about risk management here is because after we get through this section, we're going to talk about a lot of, you know, really bleeding edge stuff, some of which it doesn't exist yet. One of the big questions about the cloud is, oh my God, we have to do this massive risk assessment, and we have to have, we can't move in there because it's the cloud, and there's
bad stuff.
Lightning and thunder and
yes.
Evil things, and that's where flying monkeys come from. And really what this is about is look, there are some cases where you have stuff that is of low value, and who cares if you throw it up onto a public cloud provider and then somebody else gets access to it or whatever. So before you can start your evaluation of these technologies, you really do have just a really, really most basic risk assessment. I really look. I look at the precision of about 5 or 6 decimal
that's
places.
Awesome.
I think that's probably the most effective way to do it. 67.382 is. 0.67382 or something like that. I think is probably the best number. And no, that's not the kind of risk assessment we're talking about here. That is absolutely meaningless to a business audience. When I first did the risk assessment, this comes from the Cloud Security Alliance work that Chris and I did. Somebody was like, well, you have to classify this based on confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Well, mm-hmm. You know, the only CIA that the CEO knows is this. And they have no understanding of these things, and they don't need an understanding of our terminology and our numbers and our methods and our frameworks. They just need to know if something makes good sense or bad sense. So they need context. They do not need decimal places around the risk assessment. Examples of some of these questions are, you know, what they want to know is, how would we be harmed if the asset became publicly and widely distributed, an information asset, and that's what we're going to focus on today. How would we be harmed if an employee accessed that information asset? And so the kind of quick process that we're going to roll through here is, let's start by identifying the asset, evaluating its importance to us, map it to potential deployment models, cloud service models, sketch out a little bit of the data flow, and document it. And it's really quick, straightforward process. So we're actually, as we talked about, we're going to skip the application side. So most of what we're going to talk about today. But you know, the two main kind of things we're worried about putting up into the cloud are the actual data and information itself. By the way, we use those words interchangeably a lot. He actually squared me away on this years ago. It's one of my favorite phrases that I get the credit for more often than he does, which is why it's like kind of cool. Which is, somebody asked me, what's information? Information is data with value. So that's why we don't like calling this data security, even though we kind of have to, because that's what most people know in the common vernacular.
So before we start, though, who has formal risk assessment frameworks in place in their companies? Really? Still that? How many decimal places? Yeah, how many decimal places? Are they named? Do you know names like Octave or FAIR or, any of you use, or do you do your own? You kind of use assessments and do your own. So it's still, you know, it's surprising. It's amazing that either you just don't want to raise your hands or the fact that we still don't have common sets of risk assessment frameworks that everybody uses in such that we can ultimately, with resultant output, have the same language that we use to discuss this stuff. And that's 90% of the problem, I think, in many cases when we're trying to communicate this value issue. So,
yeah, especially because the frameworks used by the people on the business side and we use on the security side, they're two, tend to be totally separate and isolated domains. So we start with kind of, you know, what are the six key questions that, and these are the ones that I advise people to take a look at. I'm not going to walk through these. You've got it in the presentation slides or anything else. But you'll notice a key to all of these is that they make more sense. This is business context here. This isn't, you know, what percentage of risk do we face if we do X, Y, Z to the cloud? Because I'll be honest, if you think you can come up with those numbers in today's operating environment, you are smoking something far, I don't know, San Francisco. I guess it's legal now, so that's fine if you're into that sort of thing. Not there's anything wrong with that, but, you know, it.
Keep going. No, you're doing swell. I'll just be over here. Oh, look, something accidentally.
Yeah, so quit. Our presentation crashed. So let me keep talking while Chris pulls that. That's your backdrop?
That wasn't the presentation. It was something else. Look, it's there.
Okay, something else crashed. It was compliancy.
Compliancy,
attacking your
yes.
computer. So we want to put these questions into key business context. Make it so it makes sense. Those are things that the business audience can understand. If things are basically, if they can be potentially exposed, if it goes away, or if somebody else accesses who's not supposed to access it. So if we're talking about how the cloud impacts risk to our information, we have to do a couple of things. So we need to evaluate the potential service models.
Yeah, so how many of you either were at the Cloud Security Alliance Summit or have heard of the Cloud Security Alliance? Great. Oh, fantastic. All right. So, yeah, right. So that picture, the picture on the right and left, were in the guidance because I drew them. The two interesting things here are we have very reasonably precise definitions of cloud computing today in terms of where it comes from in terms of NIST. So the one on the left is a graphical representation of the National Institute of Science and Technology's cloud computing definitions. You know, you've got deployment models, delivery models, essential characteristics. The one on the right, I did trying to relate about two and a half years ago the notion of kind of the OSI stack model to a bunch of IT geeks that said, look, you know, if you want to understand cloud, then I'm going to try to build this in a way that you're used to seeing. So the one on, so if you take the definitional portions over here, and especially we look at what's called the SPI model, which is infrastructure, it's backwards, but it's infrastructure, platform, and software as a service. Really what we're talking about is from an infrastructure as a service perspective, you have facilities. On those facilities, you have your set of hardware, compute, network, and storage. On top of that is a set of intertwined kind of core connectivity and delivery functionality. And sitting on top of that is a bunch of APIs for management. So that's infrastructure as a service. Pretty easy to get your arms around. Sitting on top of that is essentially a set of programmatic interfaces and APIs used to allow you to build applications on a particular language. For example, Python or Perl or C or .NET, and that would be platform as a service. And sitting on top of that is the rest of this stuff, data, metadata, applications themselves, content, and another set of APIs or interfaces. So I broke this down because it's interesting, and if you read the CSA guidance, I wanted to be able to allow you to consume and understand how these various layers map to what it means for us to understand where information and how we might protect it and align it to a set of compensating controls and then map it to compliance. So we're going to talk about some of those features and of why that diagram is important. Some of it was related to in the CSA guide, but what the reason we kind of broke it out into the architecture versus operations and governance is to allow us to kind of dismantle these bits and pieces, mapping them to areas of concern. Which is why you had anything from encryption to forensics to application security to storage, etc. It's just meant to essentially allow us to associate what we kind of known and defined good so that we can ultimately understand the problem set.
And your risk assessment is you're going to look at those kind of key questions and map those over across to the potential service models that you're looking at. And that's typically how is security you're brought into a lot of these projects. We want to move our infrastructure to a public cloud provider, private, whatever else it's going to be. That's kind of the initial starting context for this. Then we also have the different deployment models. So the architectures here, the service models can be deployed across the different deployment models. Obviously, the one people mostly care about is public cloud. That's where people get, you know, a lot of the hubbub is when people asking questions when we're going into different environments. There's really kind of three areas we have to look at, because not just a public cloud is not a public cloud. A public cloud is this stuff on a shared resource that's available out there onto the internet. And there's a couple of different things you want to look at. What are the components we are looking at moving into that public cloud? What are the different functions of our environment that we're moving there? What kind of data are we considering moving into that? Because it's not more secure or less secure just because it's in a public cloud. It depends on what we're actually moving in there. Same, some slightly different questions. If it's a private cloud, is it going to be an external private cloud or an internal private cloud? If it's external, is it dedicated fully to us? Or are we going to have to worry about multi-tenancy issues even though it's private because then it's a virtual private cloud? And is that trademarked yet?
It's simple.
Yeah. And then we have these hybrid, which is whatever. It's combinations of everything else. And then, you know, kind of communities where you have shared communities. And now we're, okay, well, where is it located? Who's the service provider? Who are the other members of this sort of shared community? Then we have to have an understanding of how are we actually going to be communicating and moving this information in and out of the cloud. So we have to kind of do a rough map of the data flow, which is, you know, are we going to keep all of our data internally? Are we just using external shared storage? How are we getting that from point A to point B? And then once it hits point B, where is it actually being managed within that environment? And then at the end of all of that, you go ahead and document the conclusions. So really flew through a lot of that because we really want to focus most of this, and we are going to get almost half of our presentation on the important stuff, which is basically the actual innovation part of this and some of the specific aspects of the technology. The key to all of this when you're doing this risk evaluation is you need to understand you have to provide that business context. What does this mean to the business as we move across these service models, as we move across these deployment models? Now, what is the answer?
It's a blank white screen. Oh. It's a really hazy answer, as a matter of fact. But ultimately, one of the things that is important to understand as it relates to why we're focusing on information centricity is if you look at what virtualization has done to the enterprise, it has caused more organizational and operational issues and challenges than it has technical challenges. The industry, as part of that dynamic set of swings, will be able to create and invent new sets of technical solutions that over time, depending upon how they emerge, will either make a heck of a lot of sense or ultimately may not be timed well enough for large-scale investment, but will become relevant later as other things catch up. So what's interesting about virtualization is we've seen, for example, classical roles and organizations that were divided into, what do we call them, cylinders of excellence, or silos, as we like to talk about it, operationally. And what we had was, you know, we really had the network guys, we had the system administrators, and we had the security guys, three classical role definitions. And they were pretty well kind of marked out in terms of who did what. virtualization shows up, and when we're talking about infrastructure as a service from a cloud mapping perspective, all of a sudden what we saw was the convergence of roles, responsibilities, and functions where an entire, for example, network access layer got subsumed into the host and into the guest. So all of the network provisioning that you used to do as a network guy now ends up being just an LACP trunk into a server, and some system administrator who knows how to type ping, and that's the extent of his network excellence, essentially is now controlling the provisioning, orchestration, governance, and configuration of your entire virtual networks across what could be tens, hundreds, or thousands of server components. So that was very alarming to enterprises, especially then since the policies for how and compensating controls were limited. How do I provide inline firewalling? How do I do IDS and IPS? How do I do AV, right? So this notion, remember in the graph where I said virtualization and cloud, our deployment model was at the network, but we were forced to kind of push things down to the host. All of a sudden, the industry, if you look at the response of the vendor pool, basically scrambled and still are scrambling to make virtual appliance versions of their code to try to rectify the fact that the traditional network, as it used to exist, doesn't exist in the same state anymore. In fact, it's spread across states. It's virtual and physical. And why that's important is when you look at the ability then of virtualization and cloud as platforms, now we had a whole new supplier that was responsible for, in many cases, like, for example, VMware as a hypervisor or a virtualization platform provider, exposing new APIs to handle the fact that the network became this fuzzy, amorphous thing. We still had the physical network, which is just as important because somebody you had to get bits to and from those virtual hosts, but the logical network, the virtual network, became important. So that whole shift was really an issue. So what's happening now is we kind of try to settle on what the network means and how I deploy compensating controls. When you move to, and as we're going to kind of illustrate and focus on public cloud, and we'll just, let's say, Amazon Web Services, how many of you have deployed an inline web application firewall on Amazon Web Services? How many of you have deployed a network-based IPS or IDS in tap mode off a promiscuous port on Amazon Web Services? How many of you deployed anything on Amazon Web Services? Okay, fantastic. But proves my point. In many cases, you have to adapt what you do and how you do it. Operationally and technically, you may not be able to do that. So if you look at the hamster sine wave of pain, what is becoming readily apparent is as we go through these swings, focusing on ultimately the atomic unit of what is important to us becomes critical. And when we think of what the atomic unit is today, if you just put virtualization in a quote-unquote box, the atomic unit of our data center is now, especially in the enterprise and infrastructure service, is now the virtual machine, the VM, right? So people would say that when we look at this notion of perimeters and deperimerization, they say, oh, the perimeter is going away. Actually, I maintain it's not. I maintain it's multiplying. We've got more of them, but the diameter is collapsing. And what I mean by that is the boundaries around which we are securing things is now at least taking a step forward to the things that matter most, which is the VM as step one, and ultimately what we're going to talk about as it relates to cloud computing and protecting the things that matter most, the information itself. Okay? So I want to set that context because
by the way, one thing I want to add here is we're almost sometimes using virtualization and cloud computing terms synonymously.
That's right, but that's not right.
Well, it's not right, but I'm saying we need to...
That's true. So virtualization is an enabler for certain classes of cloud computing, namely, in many cases, infrastructure as a service. But even in that particular deployment model, you don't need virtualization to accomplish cloud. It just happens to be that in most of these large-scale cloud computing environments, it is enabled by some form of virtualization. Those models are not to be discriminated against. They just, from a platform perspective, yield lots of different things. So when we think about Winnovation and what it means to cloud computing and information security, we're going to focus on that information centricity part, that swing that hopefully now we are getting much closer to being able to execute on.
Yeah, I mean, let's talk about information and why it is so difficult to protect. If we think about our existing information flows, They're pretty unmanageable. We try and like develop these buckets. We have structured stuff in databases. We have unstructured stuff, which is all of the documents and whatever that proliferates among our environment. We have all of these different devices and different access methods and shared things and online and inline. I mean, it's this huge freaking mess if we try and go ahead and actually manage all of that. Because, you know, is a credit card number from a database in an Excel spreadsheet, is that structured or unstructured? I don't know. Who says it's structured? Anyone? Who says that's unstructured? Few people. That way, nobody else cares. Good. You're just here for the free food. Yeah. There's extra coffee. There's a few more. Those are raisins, not chocolate, though. That kind of sucks. Is a Google Doc structured or unstructured? Well, it's traditionally unstructured document. It's going to be stored in a structured format. Structured and unstructured is like is about as ridiculous in terms of how we tend to try and define our information-centric security as deperimeterized versus perimeter. You took out the smiley face.
I did take out the smiley
you
face.
You bastard. That was like that was my laugh line.
Sorry.
It's gone anymore.
No smiley face.
Deperimeterized versus perimeterized versus deperimeterized. What we really need to do is we need to think about information based on its use, not based on its patterns, if it's numbers or something that we can sequence. When we look at it that way, data primarily resides in two silos. So one silo, and these are like fuzzy names. I don't fully like names for this, but one silo is what kind of the enterprise application data center side. What I mean is a user goes to a structured application that's connected somewhere to a backend application server, database, whatever. On the other side, we tend to access information through our productivity applications. It's Microsoft Office Suite, it's email, instant messaging, all of that kind of freeform stuff that flies out there. And yeah, there's connections back and forth between the two. You know, document repository or document management systems are, you know, can kind of cross bridge some of those lines. But for the most part, when we think about it, it's either kind of more data center or it's more in the hands of the users on how they manage that. And so the key to information-centric security as we move across this is understanding the information flow, understanding where it is within those silos and applying the right controls in the right silos, because controls don't fully overmap yet, and then managing those phase state transition changes as the data moves in from one side to the other side and between these different silos and between these different use patterns based on context.
Was that like rock cocaine? What is that?
It's dry ice, sublimation.
Oh, yeah.
Hell, man.
Sorry.
You guys not have that in New Zealand?
State... Phase. Yeah, okay, carry on. Sorry.
That's right. You never celebrated.
No.
Never just celebrated
next
Halloween.
Slide, sir. Yeah. Please. Thank you.
All right.
Innocent
he doesn't
question.
Want me to go into details.
Really
I was going to. Oh, okay. So when I look at information security, there's really information centric security. There's really four primary guiding long term principles that we have to look at. Information, the data, must be self-describing and self-defending. Once we get down that perimeter, down to that last level of unit, we have to have some sort of defenses down because we can't get any smaller. It's like the quark, I don't know, maybe there's something, Higgs boson particles of our information security work.
Yeah, it was crack cocaine. So actually, if you map that same statement to, and you think VMs instead of information centricity, today where we are with the OVF format and virtualization, just to kind of show you this progression, we think about the same thing. We want VMs, virtual machines, to self-describe and almost call out what it is they need to be spun up, to be instantiated, right? So we have precedents here, and I'm going to kind of link these things together. So VMs, if we think of VMs as that first step towards this atomic data center collapse, and I mean that in a good way, from a perimeter perspective, and we think about this now information-wise, what we're saying is we want the information itself to self-describe and describe how it can be used. Right?
And then the policies and controls around that must also account for business context. A credit card number has very, very different meanings within different business contexts. Engineering plans, any other kind of thing that is valuable as information to us, that value changes under existing business contexts. For example, your corporate financials, big deal if those go out before the end of the quarter and the official release in your financial report, not a big deal at all. So that changes over time. It changes how it's being used. It changes based on who's using it. Next, information also needs to be protected as it moves across these silos. We have boundaries where information flows in between. And if all of a sudden we lose all of our controls on those boundaries, I'll give you a very specific example. There are most of the data labeling technologies out there today. So there was a product that I looked at that I used to not call a data security product because what it would do is it knew what server something came off of and it could kind of track it. And it didn't mark it in any way, but it was able to track where that came from. It was able to classify it based where it came from. And then as it moved throughout that environment, it would be protected. The instant that data moved out of that environment, gone. Okay, all of those controls would disappear as it was moved out. And so to really have information-centric security, we have to have ways of being able to apply those across all of those silos and as that data moves in and out of those different control structures. And then finally, the policies must work fairly consistently through the different defensive layers and the technologies we use. In other words, we need to be policy-driven. We don't want to be technology-driven. You don't want your data security to be limited. And this is why, like when I tell people DLP in the end run, you want to have a full suite DLP that covers all areas of your environment where you can set a policy in one place, have it enforced anywhere. So I think it's ridiculous. You have to define different policies for the same information in different places with different enforcement mechanisms.
Yeah, so as we think about that, and we think about virtualization, we think about cloud, we face the same problems even in the context of enforcing this from a network perspective today. right? If you think about that as network traffic or at one level or VMs at another, what we're struggling with today is binding and identifying and allowing, for example, the network and the applications and the information that interact and ride on top of it to kind of have an awareness of one another. So what we're seeing now in the first steps with virtualization and even private and in some of the public cloud infrastructure is the binding of, for example, trusted execution environments that can map network flows to virtual machine IDs, and those VM IDs can be associated with applications that traffic and types of information. Like, ooh, this app or this set of applications falls under my domain or scope for PCI. So if you can start thinking about where we are today, we are starting to emerge in the virtualization front, which in many cases is starting to feed into the cloud front. And if you paid attention to the news release here, EMC, or specifically RSA, Intel, and VMware announced on Chuck Hollis's blog, as well as that they're having a PR fest today, about how they're taking Intel's trusted TPM module, Trusted Platform Module, integrating that with next generation versions of the virtualization platforms, and being able to, for example, look at how information is being accessed, ultimately then feeding that up to things like GRC suites and or DLP capabilities. And that's just kind of from a virtualization slash cloud perspective. All of that really trends to the same sets of languages we're talking about here. Right? So this is something, if you look at that sine wave, and we talked about predicting things, when we talked about information-centric security, this language isn't particularly new. What we're going to start exploring in a couple of minutes is how we apply technology that exists today and is starting to emerge that you may or may not even be aware of, or you looked at in one instance in your enterprise as a closed, kind of behind-the-firewall boundary approach, to how that extends outside traditional perimeters and how virtualization from a larger front and cloud computing can use these exact same principles and has to in order to be successful.
Our goal in the next 15 minutes is to give you what the building blocks of this are moving forward with the technology investments you can make today that are going to prepare you for the future. We're going to give you this vision of the future, and a lot of the stuff we're going to talk about is clearly very not fully baked yet. It's very emerging technologies, early announcements. Some of the things we're going to talk about are things that we know about that we cannot talk about in terms of ascribing to particular vendors or solution providers. And so as we walk through all of those, keep in mind, we're going to talk about some out there stuff, but all of it is to give you those concrete steps to guide your decisions today in terms of adopting these technologies and in particular moving forward into the different cloud deployment models.
What do we say, like 3 to 5 year window?
Three to five years. Yeah. We can't predict any further than that, but some of this stuff is clearly not going to be baked until for another 3 years or so.
Right.
So this is what we call the, I wrote it. This is the information-centric security lifecycle. I'm allowed to brand my own stuff, I guess. And what we're trying to illustrate here is that there are sets of technologies that you can apply as data moves out through its different phases in its lifecycle. And this is not, for those of you, information lifecycle management, we had to throw all that out of the window because it doesn't make sense to anybody except ILM product vendors. And we had to go to something that's going to make more sense to security guys. So if we think about a piece of information, we create it, we store it someplace, we use it, we share it, we archive it, and eventually we may destroy it. Now, within those all of those different phases, these are the major controls that can apply. Now, what's cool is this can be actually kind of hard to implement in existing environments, even with the technologies that work, because of the complexity of how information is used within our environments and the immaturity of the various technologies out there. But we're starting to actually have a serious advantage as we move into our cloud deployments.
So are you saying that for example, in summarizing that greenfield opportunities for new apps, we have an advantage, but if we're trying to port over legacy applications where we have trouble and a lot of dependencies, that's very difficult in the cloud?
Yeah, that's exactly it. And this was, I forgot you were, we prearranged that queue.
Yeah,
I forgot about
great.
It. So
thank
I moved
you
too
for,
fast.
Yes.
We're bad with scripts and stuff. Yeah, so this is the problem. A lot of the reason we have a serious problem today is it's very, very hard to change existing business process and existing infrastructure to implement this in your current environments. I get calls from people who are like, yeah, we just started a new business thing with these guys in China. We've been exchanging engineering plans and stuff. And we think we need to protect that stuff now. Can you help us? I'm like, yeah, send me your resume because that's pretty much all I can do for you at that point. But the thing about the cloud is it is nearly impossible. It is far harder to just move a legacy infrastructure into the cloud than to redesign it for the cloud. And we've never really had much of these opportunities before where the disruptive innovation actually forced us to change that infrastructure so we can't actually deploy a mainframe into the cloud. I don't know. I guess
no,
we'll give it a shot.
Go to IBM's booth, says you can, actually.
Oh, sorry. Well, we can do the cloud in the mainframe.
That's true, in a
so
box.
So because of this, it's creating a new advantage for us on the security side. We can get ahead of things. Because what we're doing is we're centralizing while we are decentralizing. We have the opportunity to redefine information flow, apply more granular controls. And the less you control the infrastructure, the more the perimeter condenses around the information. So where's the cloud fit into all of this again? If we actually look at where the information itself tends to reside within the cloud, it tends to fall across those areas, which would be readable on a different screen potentially. If you want a copy of these slides. And then in terms of where the data security controls can be applied, if we're down in the lower levels in the infrastructure as a service area, well, there you have to apply your information sensor controls at the actual, either at the customer application before the information is sent into the infrastructure, in the original or the originating productivity application. So as you move it in, you have the responsibility for implementing that. As we move into the middle section, kind of the platform as a service area, there, well, you can do it kind of on your side. You might be able to do it on the other side, depending on who your service provider is and what they've exposed to you and what they offer. And then if you're using software as a service, all of that has to reside within the application that you've actually subscribed yourself to. So
yes, this is the yeah, but slide. So the yeah, but slide is ultimately, when you think about who owns security and where the responsibility lies, like you can outsource responsibility in cloud, but not necessarily accountability. And when we look at the SPI model again, the software as a service, platform as a service, infrastructure as a service, and we move kind of from left to right, the line of demarcation of who owns what and where the responsibility lies is in these little orange lines. So in infrastructure as a service, all of the moving parts is abstracted for you, and the service provider essentially is responsible for maximizing availability of that platform, and that's their focus. Not confidentiality, not integrity, availability. And so everything above that orange line on the left, the VMs and containers, the operating systems, applications, and the data, that's on you. You still have to engineer all that stuff, just like you do in the enterprise, right? You still are responsible for securing the majority of the operational elements associated with security. If you go up the stack to platform as a service, they can, you know, do some very interesting things. They can prevent you from making stupid human tricks like buffer overflows by enforcing class structures during development process, which is pretty cool, right? So there's some opportunities here. And in fact, most of the infrastructure providers are clawing up stack and adding library functions and APIs to allow you to develop your apps in a more secure way. Software as a service, right? So in that particular case, I should say platform, you're still responsible for applications and data security, or information security in that case. Software as a service, they kind of ultimately, besides provisioning and role responsibilities associated with who can use the application, the provider owns that entire stack. So really from left to right, what that means is the lower down the stack you go, the more responsible for securing that infrastructure you are. So when you think about the opportunities and you match that up against where and what you need to do to profile those information flows that Rich was talking about, your ability to actually affect change as it relates to understanding how your information is used is directly proportional to the model that you're using. In many cases, most of you, and who here is engaged in some sort of cloud computing activity today in your enterprise? Yeah. And you'll probably be using all three variations, right? So it's really important to understand the differences in these stacks and where you can actually affect control. So this is a key point as we go back, because many people say, look, I can't control the information once I don't own where it is actually created or used. And that's very true, especially if you look at how things are done today. So in the next, 11 minutes, we're going to talk about some tools that, due to timing, technology, culture, economics, all sorts of interesting things, may not have really been ready for prime time in the past, but are starting to evolve today. So we're gonna point to some of these, sprinkle in some kind of poignant things, and when you go to the floor and you start looking at some of these vendors, or you explore some of the things that are coming becoming available, how you might think about applying them as part of your managing Winnovation in terms of how you deal with disruptive innovation like cloud.
So there's really four key building blocks in terms of the technologies we're going to use. We have labels, data labels, label security. We have encryption. We have enterprise digital rights management. We have data loss prevention. And DLP, not like this generic kind of scanning the network, and we're going to stop all your leak stuff. I, When we're talking about DLP, we're talking about content-aware tools that are able to scan within your whatever that's been fed to them, a network stream or whatever else, and are actually able to understand what the content is inside of it as well as the context is around it. And then finally, identity and access management. Because if you don't know who is trying to, who somebody is, you have obviously no ability to provide any level of context around the security controls you're going to implement, because it's all user-based. Me looking at, you know, Cisco internal documents is probably quite a bit of a problem.
Thanks.
When it's okay.
We can just edit that part out, and that's fine.
Chris,
that was
a reasonable example here. So let's look at labels. So labels are applied via context or content analysis. And I'm going to give you a couple of examples. And the slides are kind of mostly for backdrop here, as opposed to talking to them for this next little bit. Imagine a world where when you create a document, it doesn't matter if you create it in Microsoft Word, it doesn't matter if you create it in something like Google Docs or whatever other service you want to use. What happens is as soon as you initially create that content and hit save, or autosave hits or whatever else, that contextual labels are first applied to it. Who are you? What's your business unit? Maybe you actually get to manually set some of that metadata that's going to be applied to that information as you enter it. And then something is going to occur where it's going to go ahead and analyze that content. And it'll say, you know what? There's a credit card number in here or a social security number. So we're going to apply some mandatory rights management, some mandatory controls to this because we found that. Or it's going to look at that content and go, you know, this kind of looks like it might be an engineering plan. I don't really know for sure if this is an engineering plan. So because users kind of forget to do stuff like classify documents, which is why data classification just is total BS and doesn't work, I'm going to go ahead and put a discretionary policy on. You can change it if you want. But by default, that stuff's going to be protected to a certain level at the time of document creation. Now, if you think this is science fiction, this sort of exists today. It is public that Microsoft has licensed a content analysis technology from RSA, the Tablis, which is a DLP-based agent. It is public that some of the digital rights management vendors have actually partnered with some of the content analysis vendors, and you can put plugins into these documents, into the Office suite, so that you're able to go ahead and automatically, at time of document creation, apply rights. Is it fully baked, ready for prime time? Probably not. RSA people don't yell at me. But it is existing. This is very, very clearly kind of the future of where this is going, because we just cannot expect users to manually manage this stuff.
There's also some other examples today that exist in both the cloud platforms like Google Docs. There is a clear advantage when we say in cloud, the ability, if you're using applications that are cloud-based, to enforce this capability, do tagging, do label application, since it's all running out of the same place and you know where it's stored and you know how to index it. While there are certainly evil things that can be done with that that information, it is interesting to note that you can simultaneously apply that capability. Or you can use a combination of cloud-based services today that interact with any platform you have to do it on the originating platform where it's consumed. And ultimately, then, if you distribute that capability using cloud-based services, you're able to intercept information before it essentially gets misused in places that it might otherwise have gone unnoticed.
Now, when we talk about the collapsing perimeters of information as well, where the perimeter is kind of has been now is at like the database level or the document level. What's really, really becoming super cool is that we're now getting down to the ability to do inter-document classification or inter-document management of content. So instead of having to do a DRM and apply it completely to the Word document, you can only apply it down to that section. Here's some specific examples. What you see up on the screen here today is actually, this is a .docx file format. All it is a zip file of XML content. And so it gives you actually the ability to go ahead and be able to manage stuff at a more granular level. In the databases, we can actually do that at the row level, and there's technologies emerging to potentially be able to do that at the field level. So both within our structured environment, the database side, as well as within the our document-based formats, we're now getting to a more granular level. We're not having to classify everything at the top level. We can get into the sub-levels of the documents. Here's another example of this. If you have looked at the preview for the beta for the next versions of Office, what they've shown is collaborative editing. And not just Office. There's a bunch of cloud-based tools, actually. I've used some of these in terms of editing as well. Multiple people, multiple documents at the same time. They can actually block down page elements. So I think Microsoft's doing a paragraph-level lock. Some of these other tools, it's sentence level or paragraph level or word level. Whatever it is, it actually will lock those sections so whoever's working on it, they're not stepping on each other to work on it. Well, there is no reason for me to believe that someday in the future we will not also have the ability to go ahead and apply our rights management at those levels, at the sublevels within the document. And if you have something and you want to pull just that one sensitive bit out and it declassifies the document or lowers that classification level, there's no obstacles to that from a technology perspective.
By the way, we first saw that 8 years ago, at least 8 years ago, with some of the progenitors of what were DLP. So we got to kind of skip, but we got to keep going here.
Yeah, and so the other last kind of bit of how this stuff comes together is what I call cross-domain information protection, which is where when we pull something out from a database, for example, where it has a row label, and that row label might not be manual, it might be automatic, the DLP thing can go through and automatically classify that. And we pull that content element out and we put it into a document. Well, it resides in a repository that we have control over. And as we move it into another repository, we can have a trust relationship between that application and that source database. So in other words, this information is not allowed to leave the database and be pasted into this document unless it's the right user in the right environment that meets those rights management requirements. Then those rights can apply to just those parts of that document. We've already talked about how now we have the inner document the inner document rights management capabilities within that document, and then as that moves around into these other environments, that piece of data is collected. And so this is why it relies on a combination of labels, which is sometimes we do apply some manual tagging for a variety of reasons, as well as the real-time content analysis to detect this stuff at the point of creation instead of us just trying to detect it as it's leaving the network. And so for that also to basically work, we have to have the control, obviously, over those source and the destination application, those sorts of things. But all of these technologies, they have existed before. They are maturing over time. And we're now being able to deploy those into some of these cloud models. And so for time's sake, I'm just going to blast through. So for example, software as a service, we have a lot of control. If you've got a SaaS provider, you trust your SaaS provider, doing all your document creation, everything in there, we have a lot of control. Maybe not cut and paste if they manually go through, but that's typically a low-level risk. And even actually, there are things that can manage that out there. We can actually have those rights applied within that environment, and then if you export the document, you can automatically apply the digital rights management. And I skipped a little bit of a step here, which is when we're taking this information for this work, what we're talking about with digital rights management or enterprise digital rights management or whatever else you want to call it, we're encrypting the information and we're applying the policies to that information. So that's the ultimate protection. It's not labels that are unenforceable, because all you got to do is strip the labels. It's the fact that the data, as well as the information in terms of the rights applied to the policies, are both encrypted in that.
So we provided these slides for you ultimately. So when you get them, you can look at the different methodologies being employed both in the enterprise today with standalone applications, but you can also start thinking about how the benefits of cloud computing applications, especially in the software as a service model, will allow you to enforce these capabilities in ways you weren't able to before. They have to be balanced with other issues that we've talked about that clearly, for example, if you read the CSA guidance, refer to. But, I mean, ultimately, besides the document formats themselves, you're seeing vendors that at the platform layer, both at the virtualization and cloud layer, start to apply at these platform layers things like DLP capabilities. They're starting to prototype how they will intercept traffic based on your policies, whether they're infrastructure, platform, or software as a service. We see things like data dispersion, which is basically taking information either at rest or in motion and splitting it and essentially allowing you to use a combination of encryption and key management and community of interest definitions to be able to scramble data and allow it to be reconstituted only by authorized parties, but do so in ways that allow you to take advantage of shared infrastructure, right? And then use things like trusted platform modules to ensure trusted execution environments. So there's an awful lot of stuff that's going on right now in your enterprise with the advancement of virtualization technologies that are in kind of a wave action, move to cloud, both public and kind of private clouds, and then move back in terms of capabilities as enterprise customers demand more security capabilities out of cloud providers. Right? So when you think of this, it's about content analysis fully integrated in both productivity and transaction-based processes and applications themselves, the rights and thus the encryption applied at the point of creation so that you can manage this throughout the stack, choke points between the on-premise and off-premise and being able to access anything from anywhere on any platform and be able to essentially have the network, the endpoints, and anything in between interact with that content and data. So the real interesting thing here in the last couple minutes is that when we think about cloud and information centricity and the move to cloud more specifically, we're asked what's the future of cloud. And we look at netbooks, and we look at thin client experiences, and we look at mobile handsets. So from the perspective of the future of cloud, if you were in my keynote at CSA, there are over 4 billion mobile handsets in the planet today. Not all of them smartphones. There's almost 7 billion people. But if you look at that ratio, that's enormous. So when we think about what this means, and we go back to what we started with in the beginning, we're seeing the mass re-centralization of content and applications from these mega service providers, mega cloud providers. But we're seeing the mass decentralization of the same sets of content and applications on these things simultaneously. So if we don't focus on our ability, and we don't become information-centric, the challenge we have is that ultimately, I think what we'll discover is that the back-end stuff that we're dealing with when it comes to cloud and how we secure it becomes less and less important, but it's how it's consumed that matters, right? So where are you going to choose how and where you're going to invest? And I think what you'll find is if you go back on the floor and you look at vendors in different ways about their approach to security, you'll find that ultimately a lot of them are really hinging on the same theme from last year, information centricity, but it's dressed up in cloud clothing. So with that, we actually managed to get through our slides. What we gave you was a kind of a taste of where some of the stuff that you might have looked at today when you go think about those and talk to those DLP vendors that look like boring DLP vendors today, but you look at the announcements by cloud providers and you see the similarity of approaches, I think you'll find some very interesting approaches to protecting your information and assets.
Thank you for your time.
Thanks very much.
Just very quickly, as folks leave, there are...